two of the questions and answers. We have a question from Marcos from Spain. Marcos sent us an email as well. He said, what's your favorite track ever? Again, I presume that this is for drifting. I would say I really love our home track, Zandvoort, which is a track in the dunes, which is very special in my country. My whole country is flat, it's super flat. There's very little elevation, but our national racetrack that's also going to host the Formula One, hopefully in September, has huge elevation. It's a super nice track, super nice location, and that's a fantastic track to drift. Sadly, drifting is outlawed over there right now. That's another story in itself, but it's a very, very nice racetrack. It's been rebuilt, I think, in 2018 or 19. Very, very nice track. It's also the favorite of a lot of race car drivers because it's like an old school, very technical track. Love that track. Fantastic track to drift. In America, I really like Park, the last track of Drift Week 3, which is in Oregon. Super nice track. Very small, not comparable at all to Zandvoort. It's very technical, very tight. It has a corner in the back, which is basically a triple apex, and you're kind of like, you have no idea how the car makes that corner, because it's like you're seem to be running out of road, but there always seems to be some road left, and it feels so natural. You just huck it in, throttle it. I do a lot of things over there, like when I'm chasing somebody, I'm entering on the handbrake because I want to be absolutely sure that nothing goes wrong. When I drive along, I'm not handbraking, I'm like clicking it in a little bit. And I left foot brake at one point just to get the car, the nose, to get like maybe 1 or 2 feet more to the inside of the track, more towards the apex. And then the last part of that corner, you're gonna get as much angle as you want. You're kind of like sliding it back in the pocket so you can accelerate out into a 180 degree turn that comes next, which is amazing. Like the feeling is super good. I don't know if it comes across much, but check out Chelsea's videos on it and check out the video that we're gonna bring out in a couple days about Park. Super cool track. Really love Park, fantastically done. I also like NOLA a lot. Maybe that was the atmosphere. We did NOLA on Drift Week 2. It's a typical track which was very comparable to Speed Sports and Musselman in Arizona, Speed Sports in Houston, Texas. You enter on the straight and you need to give it like a nice flick. Very, very good feeling. And you pull the car into angle, you slow it down quite a lot on the entry, and you go like over 90 degrees into the first corner, and all corners, they seem the same, but they're a little bit different. It's very, very good track for chasing. It's also an equalizer, so you can drive there with guys with 600 horsepower Corvette. You can be on their door with a standard M3. Like my M3 is like basically completely bolted on, like everything about it is standard except for the suspension. And that car, like, we could hang with everybody over there. I battled there with Hurt, I battled there a lot with Brian and Rudy, like endless battles with Brian. Obviously, MLZ is on my channel as well with the Chaser. Super, super nice. We were stacking up 4 or 5 cars over there. It brings a smile on my face. We had such a good time that we were there for 2 days. The facility is super nice. It's a huge place. It's massive, massive, massive complex. Have very good memories over there. Great job for Aaron to getting that track on the D2, Drift Week 2 roster. Very, very well done. That was probably my favorite track for Drift Week 2. So from the few tracks that I drove in America, which is Musselman in Arizona, Speed Sports in Texas, I drove Retama in Texas, which is basically a huge parking lot thing. I drove NOLA in Louisiana. We drove Mid Pond, which is fabulous racetrack. Mid Pond, if you ever have a chance, go there. We drove the Freedom Factory, Cletus McFarlane's track, and of course Clutch Kickers in Florida. All really great tracks. It's like choosing between your kids. Like Mid Pond was almost equally cool as NOLA. Really liked that track. And on Drift Week 2, we of course did Villains. We did Medford. We did Monroe. We did Park. Super cool tracks, really, really happy that we went there. All of them are super nice. They're all very different from each other. Medford, you really had to reach this very difficult track. I didn't like it as much in the beginning because I like a bit more flow, but when you get used to it, it's pretty cool for battle. So all of those tracks were super nice, but if I would have to pick a favorite in Europe, it would be Zandvoort. which happens to be my home track, but if it would be in any other country, I would also like it very much. And in America, it's probably either Park or NOLA. So I hope that answers the question. Marcos, Rainer from Germany, he asks us a question. What's the best BMW for drifting? I remember very well that I drove an E92 M3 when they just came out. It was a brand new car. It was some kind of demo car from BMW in the Netherlands. And I drove the car and I thought, because they were all manual in the beginning, so the automatic or double clutch gearbox came later with the E90 M3 or E92 M3. So the first ones were all manual. I drove the car, it must have been 2008 or something. And I thought, like, hey, this is probably the easiest drifting production car you can get, because it was such an easy car to drive. It had a lot more torque than the E46 M3, but it was much more playful than the E39 M5. So I think that that's like, if you buy a standard car right off the box, you want to drift it on the street or like have fun with it. E92 M3 is a bizarrely good drifting car. Like, we had one as a rental car from 2014. It spent a lot of time. We rented it out to clients. We did a lot of charity events with it. That spent a huge amount of time on the track. We never had any problems with it. The only weak point would be the power steering pump. I would consider taking a car like that on drift week two, although I like the E46 a little bit better, also because it's very similar to the cars I drive back home chassis wise. It's a little less complicated car with electronics and things compared to the E90. However, the E36 would be great. E36 3.2 M3 is probably one of the best cars for drift week, because it's has even less electronics than the E46. However, that was a difficult car to get in America, because the 3.2 obviously is a European version of the M3, 325 horsepower. The engine is very much akin to the S54 in the E46 M3. However, it would not be possible for us to get that car in America very easily. So that's why I choose the E46 M3. But like, the absolute perfect drift car for me, BMW, like a road car from the factory, it would probably be an E36 M3 3.2, because it's a little bit lighter, a little more simple than the E46 M3 or an E92 M3. But it may sound very, very weird, but the E46 M3 for me in the situation in America or the situation in Europe would be better, because an E36 3.2, they're also getting super rare. They're quite valuable. So I don't know if I would, you know, make kind of a road drifting car for that. When we talk about pro chassis, I think the E46 is still the best chassis. It's a little beefier than the E36 if you're really going to start putting 600-700 horsepower through it. I think that's a little more suitable than the E36, although it is possible if you look at Rome, Sharp and Jay and all those guys, obviously you can do it with the E36. I think the E46 is also easier to find. You can find a better example. Most E36s, even in Europe, are rusted or bent or whatever. So the E46 would be an easier car to find. So it's kind of difficult. E30, a fantastic car to drift. Again, like a 325 E30 in good condition, I wouldn't take that car, make a dedicated drift car out of that. It's just a shame. There are such nice cars as daily drivers and stuff. They're super valuable. Parts are expensive on E30s. Like, if you crash them, it's not that easy anymore as it was a long time ago when I was 18, 19. We drifted them a lot. It's super easy to get parts, super cheap. Now it's totally different. So yeah, I would say E36 M3 3.2. But since those are so expensive, I would probably say, like, right now, it would be an E92 M3. That's best bang for buck. A lot more beefy rear axle. You can do a lot more stupid shit before you break that car. So that's what I would say. Hope that answers your question, Marcos. Rainer, you said it, sorry. Then we have a question from Carlo from the USA, and he asks, what lessons did you learn from Drift Week? That's a fantastic question. Thank you so much for asking it, because I learned a lot from Drift Week. The reason I went on Drift Week is because in Europe, all the events were banned. So I had two pro cars ready to go, the turbo sedan and the V8 car, of course. I put a lot of work, a lot of blood, sweat and tears into both those cars. And now I had both those cars ready to go in 2020. And my email box kept getting all these notifications like, we're canceling this event, we're canceling that event. Sorry, here's your money back. We're canceling. We can't do it due to the COVID situation, this, that. So all these events were canceled. I was going crazy. I was like, man, I was sitting I'm filming this from my home. I was sitting in my home here in my living room, and I was almost getting depressed. And then I posted, just randomly posted on Facebook, like, hey, what's the best event that's not Formula Drift? in America to go drifting. And then she also replied, Drift Week. So I sent him a message, hey man, what do you mean Drift Week? What's Drift Week? And I had seen, in retrospect, one video of Luke Fink and a video of Rudy and Shelly, who were driving in a Corvette with kind of winter sports clothing or something. So I kind of saw a few things on it. I'd seen one or two clips of Brendan Wicknick in the mint-colored Lexus IS. And then I was like, hey, why is that so cool? And Shelly said, yeah, you should really go do it. And I phoned Aaron the same night on Messenger. I said, hey man, my name's Wout. What should I do? We spoke like an hour and a half on the phone. I had known Aaron from the Lone Star Drift channel. And I had a really good connection with him. I felt like, hey, this guy really gets it. Let's just do it. Then I ran into a sponsor. I just happened to run into him on the street. We live in the same city. And he said, hey, what's going on? And I said, hey, listen, I'm going to do this thing in America without even pitching it as a sponsor thing. And he said, hey, that's fantastic. Email me some things. And they helped me out with it financially. Of course, YSFAB Feel were immediately on board. Like, I contacted Tarmo of YSFAB and said, hey, Drift Week, you know it. He said, yeah, I know it. I said, I'm going to do it. He said, good, we're going to help you, of course. Same with Feel, Odi Bakci, who already backed me here in Europe. It was very easy. Like, I told Mike Monteron the idea at Feel. I said, like, hey, I'm going to do Drift Week. What do you guys feel about it? Say, we'll help you out. Seems legit. Mike Dodge, very fantastic support as well. So it all went very easy. So the lesson I learned is that stuff goes very easy if you go on a very cool event. So Drift Week is so cool. It's so real. It's so unique that the sponsors, they love it. Like, people really like it. It's a very positive vibe. It's not pretentious, like a super expensive competition. Like, it's almost like an adventure. It's very relatable to people. So that's what I learned. Like, these things, like, it can sometimes be much easier to get sponsoring for something that has this nice story, like almost like a novel. Like, how do you say that? We say like a boys novel in my country, like a book, for an adventure book. So something that sounds like that is much easier than like a pro event where you say, like, hey, we got this many spectators. It's much more driven on amount of spectators and all those things. And Drift Week is more about the adventure and the feeling, and people want to be part of that, sponsors want to be part of that. So super happy about that. What I also learned about it, I never ever drove, well, not ever, but like, it's been probably 10 years since I drove a drift car on the street, a car prepared for drifting on the street for more than 2 miles. Like, we sometimes did it with cars, like, hey, we're going to test out, let's see if this works. I drove it for a little bit on the street close to my shop, but never like really drive it. On Drift Week, I did that for the first time. It was fantastic. Like, I love that feeling. It really brought me back to the early days when you didn't have a crew, you didn't have so many spares, you just had to go drive with your friends. Fantastic. So the car is maybe 10% of the specification of my pro car, but it wasn't 10% of fun. It was probably like 90% of fun I had in my pro car. The only thing I regret not having my pro car was at Freedom Factory, where everybody was like Rudy Martinez, Adam LZ, Corey, they were running the big bank. I couldn't do it with my M3, not unless I took insane risk. I had to clutch that car. I really, really enjoyed that aspect of it, like that you can have so much fun with a relatively simple car. However, I was also one of the guys in Europe that said, like, hey guys, get the right seat belts, get the right seat, do all the safety things. And the reason why I was always a very strong advocate of that in Europe is because over here, our sport is very much under threat. So in America, drifting is flourishing. Like, they're even building tracks in Texas for drifting. So in Europe, it's very difficult. You really have to fight for it. Like, it's only going down a little bit with the tracks that allow drifting, competitions and stuff. So that's why I always say in Europe, like, hey, build a professionally looking car, make sure that people take you seriously, and don't give anybody any ammo by running a dangerous car, because if your seatbelt breaks or whatever, you get in the hospital, it's negative press for drifting, and we really can't afford that. In America, I think that even if somebody would have a super death trap car and it would make the news, it wouldn't threaten drifting at all. In Europe, it absolutely does. So that's kind of my stand, my point on it. I hope you guys like these things. Maybe I should do another one, so let me know.